So hopefully you guys can see that, right? Can you guys still see that? All right, good, good, good. And then I'll have some closed captioning so you guys can read along if you can't understand what I'm saying. This is super cool, actually. I got this from one of the workshops I went to for the training for Treasurer, and they showed us how to do this stuff. So it's pretty cool. Oh, it's not Zoom. It's actually Google Slides. Unfortunately, I think it only works on Google Chrome. So if you do it on like Firefox, it doesn't work. The closed captioning, I mean. Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's for people who are hard of hearing and just people who maybe missed what I was saying, and maybe they can just look at it on the closed captioning. So hopefully you guys could see that. Yeah, it's at the very bottom. Okay, so I'll wait a couple minutes. Celine or Bryce, hopefully you guys are letting the people in from the waiting room, because I can't see that, I think. No waiting room? Okay, no problem. Okay, so I guess we could just get started. So welcome to the CPP Game Dev Music Workshop. This is for total beginners. If you guys are familiar with music, that's okay too. I'll answer any questions you guys have. But if you guys are interested in making music for video games, this is the workshop for you. Okay, there you go. So first we have to define the music in video games. It's sort of important to understand the role that music and sound plays in video games. So when you think about any video games, so maybe Breath of the Wild, what we were just talking about earlier, and think about how it makes you feel. It could be about maybe a certain scene in that video game or just the video game as a whole. I'll give you guys some time to think about a certain video game and tell me how it makes you feel. So I guess I could start off. A game that I like to reference a lot in terms of music is the Persona series. If any of you guys have ever heard of those games, it's a JRPG. It's pretty famous, especially recently, Persona 5 that came out a couple of years ago, and Persona 5 Royal. A lot of the music there is very artistic. It's a very jazzy feel, yeah. Yeah, what's up? Yeah, same. Personally, Persona 4 Golden is my favorite game. A lot of people like to say Persona 5 is their favorite. Okay, so all the warrior stuff, that's like a type of game, right? Because I know I used to play Dynasty Warriors a lot, and that's sort of the same feel of like Hyrule Warriors or Persona Scramble. But I heard Persona Royal is pretty good. I haven't had the chance to play it yet, but I did play Persona 5. But yeah, for you guys who have played Persona, the music there is super iconic. It's a lot of jazzy feels, a lot of vocals in those music, and it makes you feel, it makes the games feel really unique. So those are sort of what we're coming. Yeah, you'll never see it coming. So the main reason for music in video games, music and sound in general actually, is for association. So not a lot of people, haven't played it, but I've heard the music, it's really good. Yeah, we'll actually be listening to some of the music from Persona 5 in a little bit. But the main reason for music and sound in video games is for association. So not a lot of people realize how much we use music in terms of association. So let's talk about some sound real quick, actually. So music is sound, but sound is not necessarily music. So think about how rectangles or squares can be rectangles, but rectangles are not necessarily squares. That's sort of the main idea of it. So music is sound, but sound is not always music. So sound effects in video games are the most obvious examples of how sound serves the purpose of association. So even in the first video game, so even as early as Pong, right? As simple as a game like that still had sound. It still had the sound of the ball hitting your paddle whenever you played Pong. And that association makes you think, oh, I've hit the paddle with my ball, or I hit the ball with my paddle. So you can think about noises like Mario picking up a coin or drinking potions in Minecraft and so that sort of thing. So you know it works well when you can hear this sound effect and you can already see what it looks like in game. So I just have a couple of examples here for you guys. So I'll play some of these sounds and see if you recognize where they're from. I'll play it one more time. Yeah, so this is the Minecraft drinking water. Same thing. So this is sort of a demonstration how even if you just hear it, you don't have to see it, but if you hear it, you know what it sounds like. So that's what sound does for music. So let me play this one. Yeah, Mario, yep, okay. So yes, this is actually the coin sound for Mario. Again, very iconic noise. It lets you know that you've gathered a coin. We could go deeper into the point of sound effects. We could, the main point of sound effects in video games is not just for the association, but it has to do something with player satisfaction. So think about when you, like in Minecraft, when you break blocks or whenever you pick up blocks, you hear that little blop, blop sound. And that sound is that player satisfaction, that association that lets you know that you've picked up blocks and so on and so forth. So let's relate this idea of sound to music, for example. So music works the same way, but while sound is mostly to an action, something very, really short-lived, music is more to an emotion. Music is most commonly used as an association to emotion as opposed to action in sounds. So does it make you feel happy or does it make you feel sad? Does it make you feel nostalgic in any way? Is it epic sounding? They can accompany certain scenes, areas, or even characters in a game. I'm sure you guys are very familiar with like character themes in music, or you guys are very familiar with the sound, the music that's played in a certain area. So if you've ever played Pokemon games, the route music is something that comes to mind as music that is applied to a certain area. So for example, we have Aerith's theme from Final Fantasy VII, a very iconic character theme. While it is a song or a music that is associated with the character, that music is still associated to an emotion. For example, whenever you hear Aerith's theme, it makes you feel sort of lighthearted or bittersweet, especially, I forgot, but it's the same with the remake. Yes, so the remake, so actually the Final Fantasy remake is just part one. So I don't think it gets to the special part that happens with Aerith, but I do think her theme still plays in Final Fantasy remake. We also have Doom Eternal in the Slayer Gates. If you guys have ever played that game, the Slayer Gates have the special Slayer music whenever you go beat up demons. Yep. And then of course we were talking about Persona. There's cafe music that plays whenever you're in the cafe area. So we'll talk about sort of composing music. So music can be really basically like it's the two split into two components, which is the melody and the beat, or the percussion, if you'd like to say. Those are sort of the simplest ways you can break down music in general. So this is what it looks like in Chrome Music Lab, SongMaker. So this is actually the program we're going to be using. I'll post the link in the Zoom chat for you guys when we use it later, but this is the program we're going for. It's a lot, it's pretty similar to some MIDIs or some DAWs, but I choose to pick that because of the simplicity. we'll get into that sort of stuff later. So this part right here, this part that you see that's moving and changing, this is the melody. So the melody is the main theme of the song. It's what carries the emotion of the song itself. And usually it's the tune that is most obvious to people. And it's something that you can easily sing or hum to. So if you think about, let's say Aerith's theme, which we'll discuss later, unfortunately, well, actually let's talk about like Breath of the Wild, because that's something that you can think, right? Like the horse riding music. So that we were listening to earlier, or for example, Revali's theme that we were listening to earlier. It has a very familiar tune that you could sing pretty easily if you remember it. The next is the bottom thing we have right here, which is considered the beat. So the beat, let me move this because I can't read it. So the beat is the support of the song, and it's what guides the song. It helps determine and define the speed and the feel or groove, if you're fancy, of the song. Okay, so let's go back and let's analyze some of those songs we were listening, we mentioned earlier. So actually, let's start off with the more simpler, a little bit more obvious. We'll start off with Beneath the Mask, Persona 5, which is from Persona 5. So we'll take a listen to these songs and let's see if we can sort of differentiate between a melody and the beat in the music. So for some reason, it won't let me stop the music. It'll just keep playing infinitely if I don't tab out of it, but yes. So the synth piano is the melody. The vocals will work the same way as well, right? When the vocals come in. But before the vocals, those synth piano, the dun, 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 that works as the melody. And obviously the drums, that really sick. I don't know if you can hear me beatboxing, but that's sort of the beat that we're getting. So that one's a bit easy. The drums come in right away. The melody's pretty easy to hear. So now we'll talk about Metal Hook, which is the song for the Slayer Gates in Doom Eternal. So this one's pretty loud. I don't know if I can adjust the sound of it, but just prepare your ears for how loud this is. Again, I have to tab out so the music stops playing. So that one, the drums are super obvious, right? It's very heavy bass, a lot of crash cymbals. And then the melody actually comes in a bit later, which is that really, really, that really heavy, that really dirty electric guitar that comes in towards a little bit further into the song. So now we're gonna actually examine Aerith's theme from Final Fantasy VII. I really like this theme. It's one of my favorite themes. It's so nice. So we'll listen to it. Yes, Aerith is best girl. A lot of people say that Tifa's best girl, but I don't know. Aerith's pretty good. Hard to imagine because that isn't the emotion that we're going for in the song. sadly, we have to stop listening to the music real quick. So we have the melody and the beat, but what else can we have? So obviously, in all of these songs, it isn't just the synth piano, it isn't just the drum set, or it isn't just the electric guitar that's playing. We actually have other things that are going on in the song. So it's going to be sort of this little section that I have here. And we call that in music accompaniments. So an accompaniment, much like the beat of a song, supports the main melody. And like a beat, it is often repeated and sometimes doesn't change. But unlike beats, which are usually played by drums or other percussion instruments, they can be played by other instruments like pianos or bass guitars. So you can consider a beat as part of the accompaniment, but for this workshop, we're going to treat them as separate. So a good way to sort of determine the difference between a melody, beat and accompaniment is to see visually how it looks on like your sheet of music or inside of your workstation, what it looks like. So oftentimes melodies will, so all of the beats, accompaniments and melodies all have loops, right? They all loop within the song, but sometimes the loop, the difference in the lengths of those loops are sort of what makes it obvious which is which. So if the loop tends to be longer, like it takes longer for the loop to start over, then it's probably the melody. But most of the time for like drums or accompaniments, the loops are a lot shorter. So they happen more frequently than the loops of the melody. So that's one way to sort of see the difference between those. So if we were to apply sort of like rock band instruments to the melody, beat and the accompaniment, the melody would be played, would be akin to or played by the electric guitar. The beat would be played by the drums, and then the accompaniment would be played by the bass guitar. So sort of to help visualize what those would look like. All right. So, oh wait, there's a little piece of information. So a song doesn't have to have an accompaniment to it. It's mostly used to add more flavor or texture to a song. The more you put accompaniment into a song, the more complex it becomes. So obviously, same thing with art or any other form of media, the more layers you add to it, the more complex it becomes. So the most simplest layer, if we were to say this in layers, the simplest layer is just the melody by itself. And then the most basic layer, the most common one would be the melody plus the beat. And then more complex layers just is melody, beat, and then even more accompaniment and stuff like that. All right. So here are some definitions that are useful to know. I'll just go over them very briefly. If you have any more questions, just let me know in chat. It seems that a lot of you guys are pretty knowledgeable in music. So some of these terms might be really familiar to you. For example, tempo is the speed of the song and it's measured in beats per minute. So for example, 60 beats per minute would be, you know, there would be 60 beats played every minute, which is equivalent to basically 60 seconds. But it's not always sort of that the same way. So a scale, a musical scale is a defined set of musical pitches, and the key or a musical key is the use of those pitches in a song. So I'm sure a lot of you guys have heard the term C major scale before. The letter or musical note in the name of the scale is where the key would start in your music, or yeah, where the key would start for the music, yes. And then you may also have heard of the term major or minor keys before. There's a lot of music theory that goes into major and minor keys, or like what makes major and minor keys. And since this is mostly a beginner class, all you need to know is that major usually means happy and minor usually means sad. That's because of the sound that we associate with it. Chords are a grouping of musical notes, usually based on their position from the first note in the scale. So for example, if we say C major scale, then the very first note in that scale or in that key is C. So that's what we refer to as the first note. And then finally, rhythm is the pattern that is created by notes in music. Is there any confusion in any of that? I know that was a lot of stuff that I just threw at you guys. So yeah, those are some examples of some chords and some examples of like, these are mostly major chords. So C major, C sharp major, D flat major. You don't have to worry too much about sharps and flats either. Again, this is mostly beginner. We're most likely going to be working in the key of C major because there's no flats or sharps. It's very simple, really easy. So if there aren't any more questions, I will move forward. Any questions? Just want to make sure that, you know, I'm not leaving anyone behind or anything. For any of the new people, we basically established that melody and beat are the two basic components of music, and that music is an association to emotions. If you guys come in sort of midway into the presentation, I'll make sure to post the Google slides on the Discord. So if you guys want to look over the slides after, that'll be good. All right, so, okay. So how do I, oh shoot, I'm so sorry. Wait a minute. So how do I write the melody for my song? So a lot of the times it could be pretty hard to find a way to write your melody. I don't know why it keeps doing that. All right. So the melody of your song can be as simple as a tune that you really like, or it could even just be some random notes or random keys that sound really nice. So I have some tips here. These are tips from me. You don't have to listen to these tips. You don't have to follow them, but this is what I sort of my process to making melodies in music. So the very first tip that I have is that your melody can be a tune that's been stuck in your head for a while, or it could be based off of other tunes that you've heard before. A lot of art and media in general is very, derivative? That's kind of a negative term, but you understand that a lot of people take inspiration from others when it comes to media and art. So don't be afraid to take inspiration from other pieces of music whenever you write things for your melody or for your music. So tip number two, if you don't have a tune in mind, don't worry. You can brainstorm in whatever workstation or program you have and mess around with some of the notes until you find a tune that you really like. So tip number two is actually the one that I do. A lot of the times I feel like I want to write music for video games, but I actually don't know what I should start writing. So sometimes I get into my program, I just put a bunch of notes down, I listen to it, see if it sounds good. If I don't like the way it sounds, I could just change it up a little bit until I get a tune that I really like. So you can just start completely from scratch. For me personally, I actually have an instrument in my room. I have a piano. So if I want to think of a melody, I sit down at my piano and I just play some notes on it. You guys don't have to have a piano. I'm not saying you need to have a piano to, you know, make this any viola players. I play some string instruments. I don't really play viola. I used to play violin when I was younger. I can't say the same for me now, but younger me used to be able to play violin. Is there something with me learning how to play violin? Aren't violas just a little bit bigger than violins? Or are they a little smaller? I don't remember the difference. It's a bit bigger. Okay, yeah, that's what I thought. What else? Oh yeah, so again, I'm not saying that you need to have a piano to figure out a melody. It's just, if you do have a piano or if you do have an instrument, you could just play a bunch of notes and see if it sounds good. The third tip that I would go for is you should think about the mood that you're trying to convey with your melody or with your tune. Is it happy or is it sad? So remember that music and video games are used as an association to a certain emotion. So it's always a good idea to think about what you're trying to go for. Violiners, calling all violiners in chat. I think the term is violinist, isn't it? Violinist? Yeah, the closed captioning is kind of going crazy, me saying violiners. I think it's violinist. Yeah, there you go. Oh yeah. Tucson Violin is a really good YouTube channel about people who just mess around playing music. I really like listening to them. They're pretty funny. So once you get your melody, you can start building on top of it by adding the beat and the accompaniment. So earlier somebody mentioned that, oh, you make music by starting off with the bass guitar, right? So you don't have to start with the melody of the song. It's just if you're sort of new and you're going for a certain sort of mood for your song, it's always nice to start with the melody. But for example, if you have a bass guitar part or a drum part that you really like and you just want to write some music to it, you can totally start with that. So music is really nice in that it's very free form. You can sort of start wherever you want to start when you write music. As long as you maintain a structure, a consistent structure within music, you can always start from wherever you want to start. I guess the same can't really be said for, like, for example, art or film. Like, I can't imagine you would, like, get the, like, for example, film one part of the film before you film like the beginning part of the film. That'll be kind of weird. But at least with music, it's a bit more free form with where you want to start. I'm not dissing any film people. I actually wanted to be a film person before I decided computer science. So I'm not dissing any film people, okay? I'm not calling you guys out. That's just that's just sort of the benefits you get with working with music. Okay, so composing music to Electric Boogaloo. So this is more going into, now you have your music, let's see what we can do with it in terms of applying it to video games. So songs in video games are never always the same, or else that'd be super duper boring. Imagine if you had like a two second loop of some music, like let's say we had all of the components. You had the melody, the beat, and the accompaniment, and it played for 2 seconds. It loops every 2 seconds. Imagine if you put that music in an area and you stayed in that area for like 30 minutes and you hear the same 2 second loop every single time. That would be so boring, and also I would get annoyed really quickly. So the best thing to sort of avoid that is to have some variation in your music. So this is a bass song that I made in Chrome Lab Music Maker or Song Maker. I have this bass right here. So it's always good to start with a bass with your song before you start variating it. Remember the bass should include a melody and a beat. It actually doesn't have to, and you can add accompaniment if you'd like. Easy ways for making variations would be to either add or remove certain parts from this bass. So as you can see in my bass, I have the melody right here. I have this accompaniment down there, and then I also have the beat or the drums down here. Again, these are all just suggestions. You don't have to follow, you don't have to like completely do what I'm doing, but this is just a suggestion for what you can do if you're unsure of what to do. So this is the very first variation we do. So the very first variation that I did for my song is I added to the melody. So as you can see, sort of the difference between the two is that I added some chords. So I added some two note chords right here for the melody. And then I also added some sort of in-between filler for these empty musical bars right there. So you could see sort of that difference when I switch between the slides like this. I hope everyone can see that difference in the music. So that's one of the first variation that I did, is I added to the melody. So the next variation you could do actually is to just get rid of the melody. So you can see I have the melody here, and then in the next variation, I just don't have the melody anymore. So these are actually two variations. I have variation two and three. So the very first variation was removing the whole melody. And then the second variation was just removing part of the beat. So you can see it kind of splits half in here in the middle. So for the whole thing, I removed the melody, but then in this part, I also removed part of the beat. We'll be listening to what the song sounds like later. So the next variation, this is the last variation I did for my song, was I added back the melody and I still kept that part of the beat out. So this is the other variation. Again, it's music is very, very free form. You don't have to follow exactly what I do, but this is sort of an idea of what you can do. Some other ways to vary is you could have different sections of music where one section of music is different from the other. So we heard, for example, in Eric's theme, there was a really nice piano in the beginning before it transitioned to a part that had a lot of woodwinds and strings. So these are that's a form of a variation, but instead of a variation where it's removing the melody or adding the melody, it's just changing the whole melody. So splitting it up into different sections. So that's sort of the idea. I guess what I would say though, is if you do end up splitting your song into different sections, you always have to make sure that the structure of the song is the same. It would be really weird if you had this really nice, beautiful, like bittersweet piano part, and then you added really heavy drums and electric guitars halfway into the song. Unless that's the mood that you're going for, you can go for it. But that's a lot of creative whiplash right there. This, even though music is free form, you could do what you want. This, make sure the structure of your song is consistent. All right. So before we actually head on to Chrome Music Lab, you might be thinking, why are we using this really weird online browser to make music? So a lot of you guys have worked with music, and if you guys visited actually the the meeting we did earlier this week, we saw some of this stuff. So I'm sure you guys, if some of you guys don't know, yes, whiplash is a really nice word. I'm sure some of you guys know or don't know what this is, but these are what the usual digital audio workstations look like, or DAWs. So for most beginners to music, this looks super intimidating, and sometimes a lot of DAWs can be pretty expensive. So this DAW right here, the one in the top right corner, is actually, I'm pretty sure this is FL Studio. I use FL Studio, but I only use the demo of FL Studio because FL Studio, even just a basic one, is $100. And as us broke college kids, it's kind of hard to find that money, especially when we have to print college loans and stuff like that, or, you know. Yeah, you have to learn a lot of stuff in DAWs. There's a lot of interfaces that I'm sure that if you were a beginner in music, they're super confusing. Like even for me, when I first started using FL Studio, I was so confused. I just didn't know what a lot of the buttons did. It took a lot of me messing around to figure out how to mess with FL Studio. So the purpose of this workshop is to learn how to compose music instead of learning how to use certain DAWs. So if I were to teach a class about how to use FL Studio, that would be completely different from me teaching you how to just write music. Yeah, Ableton Live is $90. It's pretty high up there. And if you like the really high end stuff, is like we're reaching in like the $200, $300 range. That's pretty big. So there are a lot of good and free software for making music. A lot of them we actually talked about in the earlier club meeting. So there's Beatbox, there's GarageBand, and then there's MuseScore, which is the one that I usually use. Because as somebody who knows how to read classical music, that's how I like to write music. I'll post some links to the free software later on after this presentation or after the workshop. I'll post it in announcements. So if you guys are interested in downloading some of the free stuff that I mentioned, then you can go ahead and mess around with that stuff. So this is the demo I made using Chrome Music Lab. So we'll actually listen to what this sounds like. So that's the piece that I wrote using Chrome Music Lab. Somebody mentioned earlier that, oh, what if you just start writing with the bass guitars instead of the melody? That's actually really funny. That's what I did for this one. I wrote this bass part, this bass run first before I wrote anything else because I thought it sounded really cool. So that's sort of elaborating on how you don't have to start specifically at a certain place. Music is very free form, like I was saying earlier. So this is the same song, but this time I wrote it in Beatbox. We can, even though we're working with Chrome Lab, if we have enough time, we'll actually go to Beatbox. I'll teach you guys how to use Beatbox, and we can make some music in there too. As you can see, it's the same song, but with that beatbox touch of that 8-bit, 64-bit music. And then finally, this is MuseScore. This is the one that I use. Again, while MuseScore is free, I really recommend it for people who can actually read music. I'm sure if you can't read music, this looks like a bunch of sticks and dots on a bunch of lines with weird symbols. It could be a bit confusing. But if you are familiar with musical notes and how to read music, I highly suggest MuseScore. It's a really nice program. you can hear sort of the difference in the three pieces, even though it's the same song. Those are sort of what those different programs can provide for you. So here are some suggestions for free music writing softwares and DAWs. Again, we had MuseScore, Beatbox. We also have LMS, LMMS, which is it's a really nice free to use DAW. It looks a lot like the Ableton and FL Studio and stuff like that. There's also Family Tracker, which we covered and discussed over last time in our meeting. That uses the NES sound card. So the sounds that you can get from there are pretty limited, but if that's the tune that you're going for, you can use Family Tracker, it's free. And then finally, we have GarageBand. And sadly, GarageBand is only for iOS users. So if you're an Android user, you unfortunately cannot use GarageBand. I know. I considered switching over to an iOS, getting a MacBook or getting an iPad just so I can have GarageBand, because GarageBand is so nice. But unfortunately, we can't have that stuff. It's sad. But Sam, I really want to try this program, but I don't know how it works. It's okay. It's okay, chat. I know you're concerned. Messing around in these programs is enough for you to learn how to use them. And you can even switch up some tutorials online or on YouTube. So I was talking about FL Studio earlier, which is a really nice DAW. But when I first got it, I really did not understand how to use it. There was just way too many interfaces. There were a lot of sliders and knobs that I didn't understand what they did. But once you get to spend some time with the program and you just mess around with it, eventually you get to learn how to use them. So don't be intimidated by any of these programs, just feel free to use them. And finally, these are some useful links if you want to learn more about music and video games. I used some of the information in this. Some of the information in this PowerPoint I got from these two links right here. So this is an article right here, and this is a YouTube link. Again, I'll be posting all of this stuff in the announcements after the workshop is over. So that's the end of this presentation, but we are now going to head on to the Chrome Music Lab. Let me post that link for you guys. There you go. So that's the link to the website that we'll be using for today. So actually, if I can, all right. So you guys, I've made it so that you guys can share your screens. So you guys should share your screen so I can have see what you guys are doing. Try not to share your sound though, so be mindful of people who want to listen to their stuff. I just want to be able to see what you guys are working with, and we could just sort of walk through it together, and so that you can see what other people are working on as well. So I will share my screen. Okay. So chat, I need to see chat. Okay. So this is what it looks like. This is a song, again, I wrote from earlier. This is the full scroll. I'll just walk through what some of these buttons do on Chrome Music Lab. So these two buttons right here, these change the sound, these change the instruments of your song. So this very first button on the right changes the sound of these notes. So right now I have it set to synth, but if I set it to marimba and I play it, you can hear, you probably can't hear it actually. Just give me a sec. Oh, it is. You can't hear. Okay, never mind. All right. So you can hear now, instead of the synth noise, it's actually playing a marimba. So you can also make it a piano. That's what that sounds like. So these are just the different ones for that one. I'll set it back to synth. Whoops. And this one is just for the beats. So I have it on electronic right now, which is an 808 pad. If you're familiar what 808s are, I could just put it to woodblock. That's what that sounds like. Or just a regular drum set kit. So pretty limited on the noises you can make, but it's simple enough for us to be able to use it in this program. We also have this tempo right here, which we talked about earlier. It's just the speed of the song. So if I just cranked it all the way up to 240, this is what it sounds like. You can't even hear the bass line. It's happening way too fast. Let's see if I just slowed it way, way down. sounds super lethargic and really weird. So I'm gonna put it back to 120. So 120 is the most basic tempo. That's what a lot of, like, for example, marching band songs are always almost always in 120 tempo. You can always change the tempo again, depends on the feel and the beats of your music. Finally, you can have this mic here. I actually don't know what this does. Let me see. Nope. Sure. Hello. Sing into your mic to add notes. Oh, it added things. Oh, I don't know what it added, but for now we're just not gonna use it. If you know what it does, or if you figure out what it does, just let me know. I actually have no clue what that does. Undo is for undoing any mistakes you do. That's pretty simple. And then save, if you want to save, if you press save, it'll give you the link to your song, similar to what you do in Beatbox. You can share it, or you could just download the MIDI or download the WAV file if you want to save it. And I recommend that you save it so that you guys can post some stuff on the music gallery, as I said earlier. Here's some settings. So you could set how many, the length of your song, so how many bars. You can also set how many beats there are per bar. For now, we'll just keep it to 4. That's the simplest, 4 beats per bar. Split the beats into is just how many, like half. So this is like eighth notes and quarter notes and stuff like that. So for now, you could just set it to, again, to 4. The scale, same thing. We'll just keeping it on major scale, and we're starting on C. You don't have to change. The only thing I would recommend changing is the length. We could do 16 bars as the max, so that's the longest you'll get for your song. And you can change the octave. So octave is just like how high your song can go. So right now I only have 2 octaves. So this lower accompaniment is the lower first octave, and then the second octave is this high melody right here. If I added another octave, for example, I have now this higher octave right here, and I could add maybe another accompaniment. Okay, so let's see. Okay, all right. Oops, I stopped sharing on accident. Okay, so let's actually make a whole new song together. Any chat, any suggestions for what kind of song we should write? What kind of feel we should go for? Why can't I open up chat? Oh, there you are. Okay. What? It keeps disappearing. Boss fight music. Okay, okay. Any other suggestions? I have boss fight music from Eric. Let's see. Okay. Boss fight music. We're going with boss fight music. Fish music. I'm down for boss fight. Okay. Well, Jesse, what do you mean by fish music? Can you elaborate on fish music? Underwater, okay. Underwater zone music, right? Okay. Wait, can boss fight music be in minor keys or major keys? Let's see. Let's actually listen to some of the boss fight music. Give me some suggestions. Let's see. Okay, we were talking about Breath of the Wild earlier, so let's do some Breath of the Wild music. So let's do the Ganons. D-O-T-W. B-O-T-W. Ganon. Theme. Let's give this a listen, and we'll just let's do phase 1 Calamity Ganon. This is spoilers. I mean I guess it's not really spoilers. We'll do Breath of the Wild Ganon because we were talking about Breath of the Wild earlier. Maybe we should do an underwater zone boss. Let's combine the ideas with underwater boss. It's really hard to tell because this main melody definitely does not sound very minor. Sonic Aquatic Zone. Sonic Aquatic. I misspelled Sonic. Sonic Aquatic. Aquatic Zone. music. Sorry, I'm not very good at spelling, obviously. I can't remember what game it was, but there was an aquatic zone game, a game in a game where I just kept dying because I kept drowning. Maybe it was Sonic. Oh, it's not that. Okay, it's not that the music's bad. I'm saying the stage itself is bad. The only major sounding boss fight music I can think of is the music that plays when you have an encounter with a mini boss in Undertale. Undertale mini boss. There's spoilers. I hope you guys. Oh God. What's the name of the? Was the Dog Knight? Was that one Dusans? That's not a mini boss, is it? I don't think I don't think Sans is a. Yeah, I'm thinking Dog Fight, right? All right. Maybe this is a. Maybe you guys are just tricking me to play Megalovania now. I actually know how to play this on piano. I know how to play the melody on piano. Yeah, this is pretty. Maybe we should do like a happy boss theme. I don't know. I think the boss inside of Dark Souls are pretty happy, I would say. But yeah. I guess you can't say that a majority of bosses are just pretty happy. Plants vs. Zombies boss. The Zomb boss theme. I'm sure all of us have played Plants vs. Zombies at some point, right? This is pretty funky, I like this. It's been a while since I've played Dance with the Zombie, so I definitely don't really have this song. So let's take some inspiration from that actually. So boss music might be hard, but I think we can make it work. We can make like a happy boss. Somebody with a very joyous boss theme. So let's. So maybe let's do strings. What? Okay. Maybe let's see. I want to see what all these sound like. So definitely, if we want to go for the aquatic feel, I think marimba is the way to go. And then let's do congas. Nope. That's an aquatic feel, right? Okay. So let's take some inspiration. Let's go back to the Sonic. Is this new? Oh, a year ago. Have I? Okay. Well, we're kind of watching videos on this. It's not a game. Okay. Why does it look like Pac-Man? since it's not really a game, we will, unfortunately, we will not listen to it. Okay, so maybe we could do the instrumental one. Let's see if there's an instrument out there. So I guess something that we can talk about is that a lot of music, or the instruments that we use in music, is all dependent on the feel that you're going for. So for example, this is actually a good example, right? So obviously it looks like they're in a bayou, swamp type of area. So a lot of, I don't know if you can hear it, it's really quiet, but there's some banjo in there, and that's because a lot of banjo music is associated with like Louisiana and the bayou that's over there. So a lot of the times when you choose instruments to do certain songs, you're going for that feel of the song. So obviously banjo music is very, you can almost always associate it with bayou or swamp music, the banjo. It's really faint. It was playing earlier. Yeah, right here. There's a very faint banjo in the back. So that's sort of when you're thinking about what instruments to add in your song. Always think about maybe the area that this takes place in, the situation it takes place in. Always think about music in context. That's a good way to put it whenever you write music for your songs. So this is just fun to play around with. For the most part, if you guys want to stick around, that'll be fine. For now, I'm going to be try to write this aquatic zone type music to show you. Does it only play quarter notes? I do believe, okay, if you can see, these are actually the, if you look, it actually does eighth notes. So if you look at the, they're sort of grayed out. So there's these white background, and then the black, the gray background, those represent the different bars. So 1 bar, 2 bar, 3 bar, 4 bar, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So those are 16 bars. And each of these thick lines denotes a quarter note. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and then each of the smaller squares denotes, actually these are 16 notes, so 1, 2, 3, 4. We can't accidentals once it's in a specific key. So that's sort of the limitations of this program. Let me see. I could do chromatic. I could do chromatic scale. So actually you can do chromatic scale. So it doesn't have to be in C. It seems what you start on is middle C. So for now, we'll just make it start on middle C and then keep the octave at that range. You guys can still see my screen, right? I hope that you can see that. Yeah, sadly, you can only use two instruments. That's the limitations of this program. Again, but this is mostly just for, I would use this program mostly for brainstorming some stuff. Let's actually, you know what? Because we have some time, we can watch the video that I got this inspiration from. So Chrome Maker. So where is it? This one. So I don't know if you've heard of this guy before. He makes really cool music, but this is sort of the inspiration that I got from him. He made this song in SongMaker, and then he proceeded to make it in, actually I'm not sure which program he used, but this is sort of the idea I got for this workshop. Oh yeah, that's no problem. You can leave. Bye. Have a good one. All right, so we can watch this right now. So this is sort of the inspiration I got for this workshop and why we're using the song maker.
There we go.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another one of these where I make a song by doing a thing and I slowly suffer inside. And today we're trying out a very highly requested one. It's Chrome Music Lab. And I don't know too much about it other than y'all ever been to like a science center where they have all those exhibits? It's kind of like that, but without like the children fingerprints and the smell of like public school all over it. So it's good. At least I think. So we're going to try them out. We're going to go with the song maker and we're going to try out all these little mini other, you know, exhibits. And it's going to be some good. It's going to be a good. We can make a song in a browser. This is free. I actually feel this feels wrong. This feels like pirating software, but actually like, okay. All right, so let's just hit some notes and see. It looks kind of like my Cubase piano roll. This is some drummy boys. All right. That's right, it's 6 a.m. It's time to wake up for school. No, I'm sorry. If I know correctly as a music major, sorry, I'm actually a music chromatic. If I know correctly as a music chromatic, this basically means that I can make song very good. Okay, this probably gives me more freedom with the notes. Do I see woodwind? Oh, you all know what that means. I'm using piano. Just from that earlier example, I'm thinking a small arpeggio boy. Kind of like a, you know, Midna died in Zelda and you can't bring her back kind of thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nope. Yeah, that's it right there. That's like the beginning of a U2 song right there. Does that sound good? Nope. No.
Do you guys prefer if I put it in full screen or is the other more?
How does that sound? So now what I'm thinking is we get like a little harm, you know, we get a little harm. We got to put some harm in there. Some Parmesan cheese. Let's see. I hate it. Okay. So if I do this correctly, I can indicate what notes are which by the actual colors. So clearly purple is this guy. Ah! Let's go up here with a lead. Yep. Off. Okay. good old trackpad. Not failing me again. Wait, what does mic do? Sing into your mic to add notes? No. Please, hit the note! Hit the note! How does that sound? You know what? Some of that works. Maybe, but I gotta raise the octave on that. Okay. Yep. Make this song exclusive with the mic function. Oh, we should do that next. We'll do that next for sure. Okay, cool. And then I'm gonna add some rhythm to that. Always get the low boy in, because if you don't have the low boy to pick it up, then no one's gonna... I've run out of analogies. If this is this, right, then how do I sad that up? It's this one. Where are you? Why is that stuck in my head? God! Yeah, let's change it to, you know, let's change it to strings. Let's get some drums in there now, like, dun, dun, ch. Wait. Oh, yeah! Oh, this is now sad dating sim. Yes. Poom, tat, poom, poom. Yeah, that's it. I can be the new big rapper. Check it out. This is America. Can you copy and paste in this? I don't think I can copy and paste. Control C. Nope. Hang on. Da-da-dun-dun-da-da-dun-dun. That was almost the beginning to Pirates of the Caribbean. I hate everything. Since we only have 16 bars, each portion could be a portion, like a new portion of the song. Dun, dun, dun. We're gonna go with the old anime intro. This one says, my older brother destroyed my village, but only because he was ordered to. I'm sorry, I just started watching Naruto. So now maybe I can harmonize with that. So like, dun, dun. There it is. Now, we're gonna add some lead notes to this. And let me tell you about these lead notes, all right? Why am I incognito, someone asked. I don't want you to see how much Naruto I've been watching. Dun, 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 dun. You know, these colors are kind of reminding me of Skittle colors. But a lot of these are like the worst flavors of Skittle ever. Oh, that's not what I wanted. This could be like a build-up, so it'd be like... Bum-bum, bum-bum. Taka. There we go. 10 bars left. Okay, here's what I'm going to do, friends, in the last 10. I'm going to waste 2 of those on a really bad buildup. So here we go. It'll just be a straight, like, scale thing. So it'll be like... There we go. So that'll kind of work as a build-up. The beginning kind of teases something, and then the second part here kind of works as like a really bad, terrible like drum roll, but a drum roll of notes. If you took a piano and you just threw it down the stairs, that's what those that's what these notes right here. And now we kind of bring in the chorus. It's just gonna be a sensual blocky tower of garbage. Let's go back to arpeggio maybe. So like this again, right? Except now we go to this note. Nope. This guy, so like dun 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 dun. This one's gonna be a cheap one because I'm just too lazy to come up with notes. Dun, dun. There we go. All right. So now we just need. Let's see. Let's get some harmony in there. Dun 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 dun. Yeah, let's do that. So that weird note there, that little pink lad. He might fit with these little, he's not really dissonant, but it's a weird boy. So now let's get a nice fast drums, like boom, ta ta. I think I got the hang of this part here. I can kind of visualize it like Cubase. Wait, why is there more? Did I accidentally, like, add notes to the pre-chorus here? Oh, no. Oh, wait, no, never mind. We're good. Never mind. Okay, everyone, are you ready to hear what we did here? Let's see what it is. Nope, those harmony notes, they gotta go. Get them out of here. Let's see. Yes. Let's see how the string version sounds. You ready? Potion cello. Okay, I'm sorry. Someone says it needs to resolve. Let me show you how I'm going to resolve this. Drag out that resolve. All right, let me show you how I'm going to drag out that resolve. That's how you do it. Okay, so I actually like this song so much that I decided to kind of make a full-ish version of it. But I actually liked that version so much that I made a whole original out of it as well for my video game ideas. So if somewhere down the road you hear a song that sounds very similar to this one, but also like 20 times better, I'm sorry, I think. But yeah, check this out. Now, do you guys want a 10-minute challenge version? Go back. Your song will not be saved. It's okay, because I can't be saved. Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed that video. It was a lot of fun to make.
Okay. Oh, can you guys hear me now? Okay. So the rest of the video is just thanking
more
his sponsors.
Than...
Oops. His patrons on Patreon. So that's sort of the stuff that we can do with Chrome Lab Music Maker. You can see it was actually pretty limited what he can do. So he could only have two instruments. There's only three actors he could do. Luckily, you could actually do it chromatically. So you could have all of the notes on there. But a good way to use this program is to just make quick and simple songs. So for example, for the game jam that's coming up from the 30th to the 1st of November, it's really nice to make really quick. This is a really nice program to make super duper quick music for those game jams. It's also nice to make a song in this one and then try to transfer it over to other programs that you're more comfortable with, like what he did in the video. So this is like, again, it's just a nice and free program. We can actually talk a bit more about some other programs, for example, Beatbox. So I actually have Beatbox already open. We can talk about the stuff we can do in there as well. So this is Beatbox. Hopefully you guys can still see my screen. I think Daniel's here now. So Daniel's a bit more, I feel like he's a little bit more knowledgeable in Beatbox than I am. I did just start it a couple weeks ago. So I'm not very that much familiar with the stuff that I can do in here, but we can just see what we can do. So these are the different channels for different instruments. So we can have about four instruments at a time. So 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm actually not sure if you can change how many instruments you can have. Doesn't seem like it. I guess Daniel, if you're in there, if you can let me know, can you use more than four instruments, or is four instruments the max?
Yeah, if you go into, I think in preferences.
Okay.
And then customize all instruments, I think. Oh, never mind then.
I think those are the effects.
Yeah, okay, I think you can uncheck that. I think it might be edit.
Edit.
It's one of the ones at the bottom, either, I think probably change channel settings.
Channel settings.
Okay.
Oh, there you go, yeah. So you could have more channels. Let's see the max channels you can have. You can have six channels, pitch channels, and three drum channels. So let's just see that. Okay, so you can see. So these are what all the pitch channels look like. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then these are what the drum panels look like. You can also change how many beats there are. Here's the rhythm. So you can have triplets, you can have the standard, you can have 6, 8, or you can just freehand it. These are the different sort of loops you can have. So this is the first loop, for example. So 1 would be your first loop, 2 would be your second loop, 3, 4, so on and so forth. And those are the loops you can have. And you can add more. So 0 just means that you don't have any loop on there and you're not putting anything on there. If you start adding stuff, it'll change it straight to 1, which is your first loop. So if you change it back to 0, then it just means it's not going to play anything. Can you do so these are the drum so these are how you change your instruments. You could go here by type and you can change the type of the instrument. So it's the Beatbox already splits up the type of instruments you can have. So you can have, it's very hard to read actually. Maybe this one's a bit easier. Nope, maybe this one, that's a bit easier. Wow, these are kind of hard to read. I think the yellow one, I think this one is a bit easier. So you can see, you can edit your instruments. You can have custom, these are the custom instruments. The retro presets, you have keyboard presets, idiophone presets, you have guitar presets, picked bass presets, picked strings presets, distortion presets. There's a lot of instruments on here that you can use. It's the same with the drums. So if you go to drums, you could change the types of drums you have. It's a little bit more limited on the drum sounds, but if you want to customize what all of these sound like, you can come here and these are these filters that you have, the transitions, effects, noise. You can do the same thing on all the other stuff right here. You can change the scale. Right now I have it to normal. So if you do it to easy, it only does it for the scale that you have. But if you do normal, I'm pretty sure if you do normal sad face, this does all of your keys. So
this does. Yeah, I believe that the sad face ones, I think, are minor keys, and then that happy faces are major keys.
Okay, I see. That's interesting. So normal would just be your normal major scale. I don't remember if this is chromatic or not. Let's see. And you can have up to, let's see, 8 different kinds of loops.
So actually, on the note of number of patterns, you can change it, and it doesn't seem like there's any limit to the number. Okay, so
let's see. So edit channel settings.
Patterns per channel. I just like started cranking it up and like went up to 40, and it's like I'm never gonna run out.
Yep. Okay, oh, it goes 128 is the limit. I'm just gonna.
Yeah, and then you can the instruments per channel. I think just makes it so that multiple instruments play on each note, and you can like customize.
How
do
you?
All that.
How would you change that?
Actually, one thing that might help.
Instrument 10. What do we do?
You do. Go to preferences.
Yep.
Do full screen layout near the bottom.
Oh yeah. Oh, that's a lot nicer to look at.
Yeah, it helps a lot with measuring stuff.
Instrument settings. So let's see, 10 instruments. All right. Well, now I have 10 instruments, but what can I do with these 10 instruments?
Yeah, like you can't actually choose individual instruments. It just makes it so that when it hits a note, it will play like all 10 instruments at once.
Oh, which... wait a minute.
I think at the moment they're probably all the same.
Well, let's test this theory. Whoops. Sorry, I'm on my laptop, so the sensitivity of my laptop mouse is really high. It's higher than I'm used to. Well, guess, well. So these are the buttons you use to like switch to the different bars. I guess, again, so this is sort of the idea I was going for, where if you don't know much about a program, you could just fiddle around with what you can do. It's really nice to fiddle around with the settings to see what you can do. We can actually listen to this. It's different from the one that I had in the presentation, because I added these little slides.
Can you turn it down a little bit? We can't hear you too well over it.
I was just saying it's the same one that I used for the presentation, but I just added slides in it. So to see how you can do slides, you could just grab one of the ends of it, and you could just drag it up or down. Like this. And I usually, yeah, like that. You can just drag it up and down. And then if you grab them, if you grab anywhere outside of the note, like right here, and you just drag up and down, it changes sort of the volume of it. So right there, it would get really quiet in the middle. This is, it has noise all throughout. If you move it this way, it makes it quieter on that end. So that's how you could sort of customize the sound of your notes in Beatbox. This is another really nice free program. If you want to save it, you can export the song, and you can export it to Beatbox, and then you can put it as a WAV file and you can save it. To import songs, you have to get the .json files. So you have to save it as a JSON file and then import it as a JSON file. So again, another option you can use to make music.
And also one other thing that's kind of cool, when you build a song in Beatbox, it puts the entire song in the URL. So you can share it with someone just by sending them that big long URL.
Yeah, it's crazy long. Yep.
It's kind of hard to look at, but like.
Yep, that's the whole URL. It's still going. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there, it's also there. But yeah. So we can look at some of the other programs. I don't actually know if I have LMS on this computer. Yeah, Daniel has some good advice for anyone who wants to make NES style music. You'd want to limit yourself to 2 channels with square wave instrument, 1 with triangle wave instrument. Oh, the chat went away. I feel like such a boomer using Zoom. And then with 1 with a chip noise. All right, no problem. We'll actually probably end it a bit here. it seems a lot of people need to go. If you guys have classes or anything, we'll actually stop, or other clubs, I'll stop it right here. So again, I'll post all of the links that I mentioned before in chat. I'll put it in the announcements so for you guys. Have a good day, everyone. It was nice seeing you guys. Have a good day. See ya. Ooh, let's see. Let's give this a listen. I want to see what this. Oh, wait, this looks really cool. Here. Actually, before we go, we're going to listen to this. If you guys are still here, we're going to listen to this. Show screens.
It's okay. It'll be in the video.
Okay, we'll listen to this. I like what you're going for. It's really nice. Again, sadly, the limitations of the instruments, we can't put as many instruments as we can for, like, for example, beatbox or LMMS or FL Studio or things like that. But again, this is a good it's a good program to help you get started with making music. If you have an idea, and then, like what he did in the video, if you really like your idea, you can move on to your other other sides of the room. You made a drew a smiley face in the other one. Is it still in this one, or is it a different one? It's also, you can actually use it like a drawing tool. So let's say I want to draw a sad face.
Yeah. Oh yeah, it's in a different one. Yeah sure. Like that.
Let's see. You can see what they, here. I'll say. Let's see what this sounds like. All right, that's what the hello sounds like, and that's what a sad face sounds like. That's what a happy face looks like. God, it's kind of terrifying, actually. It's fun to mess around with. A lot of actually the Chrome Lab stuff, a lot of the Chrome Lab stuff you can mess around with. So you could, we could have played the shared piano. We could all play piano together. So if I shared this link with you guys, we can all play piano. Yeah, we can mess with it a little bit before you guys have to go. You guys can join in and we could just mess around on this piano. This is pretty cool, actually. Chrome Music Lab has a lot of fun stuff like this. So this is how you can play piano with your friends, social distancing piano right here. So yeah, we'll end off the workshop right here.